of expression on the internet.
Our manifesto is oriented towards two audiences, one being the users, all of us, and also the regulators, whether it is state regulators or, you know, private regulators, those who take care of the websites that we're using. So we wrote a small para for the preamble with our vision of the situation and what we believe are the lines to follow for the future. So the internet constitutes a platform of free expression for users. Websites such as Facebook, Twitter, collaborative media, and blogs allow users to add content without larger constraints. As in, the point is about defining the constraints, but at least there is no, in principle, there is no a force that moves you either to write or which prevents you from writing when you are writing on the internet. The assumption is that you write of your free will. We see the internet as a relatively free and open space in the present situation, but it is shrinking as a free entity. It is threatened by the specters of control, curbs, regulation, and censorship. Sources of control include political and ideological forces, primarily through the state, but also with other political groups. Perhaps later we'll get into.
Yeah, okay.
What is the minimum?
So, we had to think about free expression on the internet.
Our manifesto is oriented towards two audiences, one being the users, all of us, and also the regulators, whether it is state regulators or, you know, private regulators, those who take care of the websites that we're using. So we wrote a small para for the preamble with our vision of the situation and what we believe are the lines to follow for the future. So the internet constitutes a platform of free expression for users. Websites such as Facebook, Twitter, collaborative media, and blogs allow users to add content without larger constraints. As in, the point is about defining the constraints, but at least there is no, in principle, there is no a force that moves you either to write or which prevents you from writing when you are writing on the internet. The assumption is that you write of your free will. We see the internet as a relatively free and open space in the present situation, but it is shrinking as a free entity. It is threatened by the specters of control, curbs, regulation, and censorship. Sources of control include political and ideological forces, primarily through the state, but also with other political groups. Perhaps later we'll get an occasion to mention the recent case of, I think, two girls. Is it in Maharashtra?
Yeah, they, I think, put something on Facebook about Shiv Sena, and some action was taken against them. And there were other instances as well when people have expressed their freedom of expression on Facebook and have been penalized for it.
I think we have also heard of another case of I think someone writing against Modi in England, actually, and the person could be tracked by the party very fast. Yeah. Should we take questions now or at the end?
Principles.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Should we go faster, as in?
No, you can do the whole
just
thing.
Yeah.
We're not done with the preamble. Expression may also come against the business interest of certain industries. So one type of constraint is the state or political forces. The other constraint might be industries, the market. This may lead to the eventual throttling of free expression. We recommend a state implementation of greater regulations, ensuring the citizens' freedom of expression. But it must be complemented but with a deeper awareness of the scope and limitations of expression online on the part of each user. So some regulation by the market, but also some kind of online etiquette or online awareness for each user. So maybe the principles you want to take?
Yeah. So the principles are the internet and its platform of free expression are open to all individuals, irrespective of gender, class, caste, origin, etc. The multimedia formats of internet platforms allow for expression beyond the single form of textual expression. For instance, in the pre-internet age, newspapers involved freedom of expression only in the written medium. Television is through visuals, but the internet transcends all of these formats, and you can blog, you can write, you can have videos, and all of this constitutes freedom of expression. The usage of free expression should be rooted in a knowledge of rights and duties on online platforms, and of the risks of free expression online. So perhaps it's also about the concept of empowered users that are aware of what are rights and also the constraints that limit these rights. Each user's free expression is limited by the extent of another user's own right to expression and his rights against defamation, abuse of statements, and copyright infringements. Modern legal structures must adapt the description of the fundamental right to free expression to the modalities of the online media.
I think this perhaps could be could match to what we said before, but what was the formulation? Neutral legal descriptions or something. As in, we can have basically an updated description of freedom of expression on in the legal texts, which can apply both to offline and online expression with the same words, as in, you know.
Internet and online platforms of expression should be used to widen the scope of political participation. Each user can enjoy the instantaneity of mediums of online expression to put forth a variety of causes and without contributing to disorganized and unproductive exchanges. And should I take the action points? So action points are multiplying the access to functional computers with internet connection at all levels, be it local panchayats, libraries, ground panchayats, schools, etc. So basically multiplying the points of access. Clarification and dissemination of user laws, and also clarifying and explaining where different contexts are relevant. For instance, where US law applies, where international law applies, or where EU law applies. For instance, if I'm writing something on Facebook and somebody has to, takes offense against it, so which law is applicable to this particular case? I mean, we should be aware of it. Development of softwares and platforms in local languages. Development of disabled-friendly softwares. And it may not just be physical, you could have other forms of disabilities as well.
Actually this came up because we thought that physical disabled would be the usual sense of what we mean by disabled-friendly systems. But they're also social disabled, as in people who don't have access to the hardware, actually, through social restraints and social structures. And for this, we didn't know how much any implementation, any regulation or practice could change that, actually, because it's once there is, as long as there's no access to the hardware, whatever we do online even doesn't change anything, you know. So first we have to have access to the hardware. That's why the first point is about multiplying the access to these platforms.
Establishment of systems of collective regulation. Each user expresses views and regulates others. And finally, the collaborative revision of the IT Act through a feedback system or even through online collective writing.
Our group consisted of Asim, Joseph, and Mohan Kumar, and of course myself. I was unfortunately not available for the earlier discussions. I came in the morning. I thank the team for tolerating that.
One point was that when we were talking about governance and internet and public services, So there are two aspects to it, internet as a provider for public services and internet as a public service in itself. So we are looking at both these aspects. First, the more important thing we were looking at, internet as a public service in itself, and the discussions even went till should we consider internet as important as providing water and electricity by the government. So should it be treated at that level, or what should be the level, especially in information age, where should we place internet? And then the second aspect of e-governance, where internet is used to provide public services for citizens. So there are these two.
Yeah. So we just decided to divide up the task. In the preamble, we've basically made two points. One is recognizing the imperative of a framework for a democratic internet commons. We are attempting to place. We are not sort of being very prescriptive, but we are making an attempt to place some guidelines. And so by which will by definition be inclusive, universally available and accessible to all and administered by a publicly accountable body. And we have understood the need for a more accessible governance system and the utility of net enablement in this project. That is the application side, the user end of it. And therefore, we need to keep sight of the basic accountability of governance to deliver basic needs and entitlements in an equitable manner, where the human is not subjugated to the mechanical, and decision making is not at the cost of the human or the technical. And we have decided to have little portions discussing this to clarify what we had, what we talked about. So while there is a necessity to have a manifesto, we don't have the luxury not to engage. Should we do it? Can we do it? But we said there is no option, we have to do it. So we said, yes, we must. Then we need more information that we acknowledge. And we are saying that we don't have the full information to come at a more definitive space. And so therefore, we have attempted to assert the identity and agency of the individual user, but also that of the non-user. And this is important, because we have said that by virtue of age, language, or choice, they are not presently or in future a user of the internet. So I think there we have made, I think, an important point. And in terms of the principles, we've just got two or three major ones with some discussions on those things. Decision making, therefore, we're privileging the human or the mechanical, we're saying the decision making on such process should not be hegemonic. They need to be democratic, and the accountable body should be as widely representative and participatory, with another important principle, individual internet users being the primary stakeholders. In the context of a multiple stakeholderism approach, and we are saying that state and internet companies or pharmaceutical companies or whatever, these big data users, are the we have on par, we want to sit with the government. We're saying, sorry, primary stakeholders are individual users of the internet or potential users of the internet. So then their interests become central. I think we felt that was a very valuable, for me personally, discussion. The decision on choice of technology should be based on the need for increased access to weaker and marginalized sections of the societies and not merely controlled by business interests. Primary stakeholders should have major role in functioning of the internet and not proportional to their economic share. They may be very small, there may not be any economic aspect, but in other words, it should serve individual human users. Cooperative governance of the internet is a preferred mode with representation from all shades of opinion and users, because hardware, and now there's a principle we've laid down here. Why? Because we are saying that there's a huge market, Google is very large, you know, they can do it. But why in principle should it be a commons? Because hardware and systems have been designed and funded by public finance. So the government of the US, well, whichever governments, a public governance of taxes have been used to run the servers which run the internet. And the brains which design the computers and the software originally were paid for by governments, UK government, whoever. So therefore, these are basically commons. And that is the principle which we thought we should assert. and therefore this crucial aspect needs to be kept sight of at all times. For this reason, Internet Commons is subject to public accountability. Action points. I will ask him to take it up. No, please.
So as you can see, we were the discussions for us were more important than actually arriving at things, because we know the complexity of these things. So for action points, the first thing we suggest is to promote the formation of widely democratic representative body to oversee the internet. And in what we're discussing in this point is, in the climate of shifting geopolitical boundaries, we were discussing the role of UN and at a global level, how do we govern internet? And so in that shifting geopolitical boundaries and blurring of the idea of strong state and an insertion of market forces in both governance and policy decision making, a rediscovery of the democratic process is necessary to maintain freedoms and the people's control and decision making over the commons, which are the basis for human life. Second point is to work for the legitimization of such a body through building a wide consensus on the principle of democratic decision making on issues relating to internet. And here we were discussing how do we build a wider dissemination of easily understood information on technical aspects, because that has been coming to us quite a bit in previous discussions also, that we, like Vishnu was saying, we have to keep the information open and everyone should be able to access it. But that is one part of it, to be able to access it in a very functional way. But what about the social enabling of accessing that information, or if the documents are too technical for people to understand, then is it enough to just put it on a website and people can access it, or do we put more effort to make it really accessible? Like, how do we, or is it again based on some people who will again take it up and then make some points about it, but at a larger level it's still not achieved?
Just to simply restate that, to allow the non-technocrats, I mean normally the technocrats will take a decision based on technicalities. So to make that, it feasible for non-technical people to be party to the decision, informed party to the decision.
Yeah. And finally, the action point was on the e-governance part, was to bridge the gap between the provisions and the actual delivery of e-governance. It is necessary to address the issue of both political and administrative will. So e-governance has been a buzzword for, I don't know, a long time now, but whenever people go to such centers, maybe Bangalore or other places in Karnataka, there is always a problem of internet or power. So there is a lot of lip service given to e-governments, but at an administrative level, it's not being fulfilled. So how do we bridge that gap? So that is one of the action points. So here we were discussing exactly that, because of connectivity and maintenance issues,
lack of power,
it's an unhappy experience for the user. So how do we improve that quality? So yeah, that is what we came up with. I'm sorry that we couldn't give you very pointed things, but that was the complexity we felt with this topic, that there are so many things happening and somehow we have, within our limitations, we could come up with these things.